Very good afternoon to you. Today I have with me Purnima, whom we all know very well, to make sure that in this session there is no unfinished business. So she will supplement me.
We finish it off.
Yes. Okay. This was a very good topic suggested to me. And the moment I was told, why not have a session on this, it really struck me and I said, yes, and I have been working on it for a long time. But of course, I'm going to simplify it. I'm not going to talk theory or psychology or whatever it is. Let's start with understanding something very, very basic that, we have ups and downs in our relationships. People who are not very important to us, with whom we do not have a very close relationship. If there is some unpleasantness, if there is some disagreement, we decide to cool off. In some cases, we may even decide to shut off, not have a relationship with the person. But what do you do if the person happens to be very close to you, a loved one, the person who is very fundamentally part of your life? Firstly, you cannot switch off from that person just because we had disagreements or arguments or whatever it is, right? So how do we handle this? Let me first tell you about, what we do, which we should not be doing. Take any example, husband, wife, parent, child, anybody like that, somebody close, okay? So you have a disagreement. You have different viewpoints. And when each one is presenting viewpoints, what happens is that it leads to an argument. Neither party is willing to back down. But the sad thing that happens is the disagreement was on an issue. You can agree to disagree. You can say, sorry, I am not going to be party to your thinking. I have a thinking which is completely different and based on my very, very long-term experiences, I don't think I would like to change my opinion. Now, like I said, that person happens to be very close to you. It could be a person living in your own house. It could be somebody who is living far away, but you have a deep emotional attachment. Now, the sad thing we do sometimes is because we do not expect that person to disagree with us. We expect that if I am important to you, you will not argue with me. You will listen to me. But in real life, does that happen? No. The other person also has a strong view. And this happens even with children or adolescents. It can happen with very elderly people who are in many ways dependent on you, but their mind is very strong, which says, on this issue, I do not want to compromise. I do not want to let go. So when that happens, what we do is, when we get a little frustrated, when we realize that the other person is just not willing to let go or to agree with me on my viewpoint, slowly the argument degenerates from an argument of the issue to an argument on the personality. Haven't you heard people telling you, you never listen to me. You always do this to me. You are so insensitive. Then no point in arguing with you, you know. You just don't have any understanding of what I am going through. Whenever an argument degenerates into issues, people, and there is an attack on the individual who is disagreeing with you, what happens is that person wants to be all the more aggressive. I am not going to let go. Don't think that I'm going to give up so easily. And then people bring up the past. Last month also, you had argued with me. 5 years back, you had argued with me. The moment we do that, obviously, the current issue takes a backseat. And that is what we refer to as unfinished emotional business. There is no end to the emotions. Even if by chance somewhere you agree to disagree, you let go, but by the time the damage is done. So this person goes about telling everybody, you know, on such and such thing, my so and so ex hit me so badly, verbally attacked me, made me think as though I'm good for nothing, made me feel ignorant or inferior. That is regardless of whether the practical issue has been resolved or not, because it leads to unpleasantness which goes far beyond the disagreement or the argument that you had had on such and such day. So this is what, as I said, we refer to as unfinished emotional business.
In fact, I think, Ali, sometimes in such issues, our relationship with possibly their son or daughter also gets affected, because so much is our unresolved issue with that person.
Yeah.
That without ever realizing, we say, no, I don't want him, I don't want his son also, grandson also, anyone. No?
Yes, and because of that, I don't know, even if that particular issue is resolved sometime in the future, the bitterness, the unpleasantness remains for a long time to come. The problem is because we sometimes tend to become impulsive or short-sighted. We are so particular about winning this argument. We are so particular about proving that I am right and you are wrong. When that becomes our priority, nothing helps. And the relationship continuously keeps going down. There may be so many good things happening between the two of you. As counselors, we make such people who are having this unfinished emotional business with a loved one, we tell them, okay, we will discuss what the issues are, where there are differences, and which is causing you so much of disturbance. But can we look at the picture holistically? Which are the areas where you can talk to each other, you can spend time with each other, you can have meaningful discussions without primarily differing or getting into argument? And the more we hold on to old hurts, when we hold on to last month, this is what you had said, last year, this is what you said, and 10 years back, this is what you said. Now remember, however bad the argument, whatever may be the disagreements, you cannot turn the clock back. And therefore, you start feeling more and more miserable. You develop a frustration and you're not willing to let go, even on small current issues. If today I have a disagreement with the same person on a very minor issue, in the normal case, I would have said, it's not important, let go. But now what happens? I realize that when we had this big argument, the other person didn't let go. The other person has held on to it. And therefore, I am not willing to let go in this very minor argument. And you see how these things keep piling up. And because of this, our cognitive performance, our stress levels, and a feeling of frustration or getting overwhelmed, it increases. This does not affect only my relationship with the person with whom I am having disagreements.
In fact, I think sometimes we catch on to being right so much that, no, this was my point and yes, you tell me, and we keep collecting votes also.
Correct.
From all and sundry. Correct. That, you know, I was right, so I'm going to stick to
it. Yes, and nobody is interested in participating in your argument. Nobody wants to take sides, particularly because if you're close to each other, the other person is obviously, again, to some extent, at least close to each other. So that person starts avoiding you. Whenever I meet this person, he keeps talking about this arguments or this disagreement that he is having with X, Y, Z. The other thing that happens is that we are not willing to let go. What Puni said just now, in fact, with counselees who come with a so-called very serious issue, they say, I'm having this major disagreement with this person, and this person is so close to me that I cannot cut off the relationship. When that happens, I gently tell this counselee, is it more important for you to be right, or is it more important to you to be happy? You go on drilling into the right and wrong business. You take up that, you know, one-upmanship, and you prove nothing to the person. The person has already made up his mind that, no, I don't agree on this. And like I said, the person also remembers how you were nasty. You said things like, you never listen to me. You are always doing this. You are so nasty. Personal comments stick into your mind for a very, very long time to come.
Ali, does it mean that many a times without realizing, we are also not addressing that issue? We are addressing the person and maybe even tarnishing, possibly putting him down and putting down his personality also.
Yes.
Calling them messy.
That is the reason why, you know, I always remind people that how important is it? This is not a court of law. This is your best friend. This is your family member. This is your child. This is your partner. How does it benefit you if you can prove that I was right and the other person was wrong? Because by any stretch of logic, if you actually do that, the other person becomes all the more bitter. The other person becomes defensive. The other person develops a negative attitude to you. One of the ways to overcome this, you may have heard about this thing called the Gestalt therapy. G-E-S-T-A-L-T. Gestalt therapy propagates that when you have 1, 2, 3, 4 minor issues, put them all together and start looking at the total picture. In marriage also, we have this chart which we give to our DCA students. You are unhappy with your spouse. You are having arguments. You are developing bitterness. Can you do me a favor? Take the sheet of paper in which I have written down 13 different dimensions of intimacy in a marital relationship. Check out which are the ones where you are compatible. You'll be surprised. Even those who are arguing very bitterly may say that out of the 13, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, we do not have disagreements. That means majority of your relationship is going well. So can you not look at things in a holistic manner?
Ali, sometimes when we are, you know, looking and addressing old hurts, does something like asking that person, you have had some issues with the person A. So what are the happy memories and positives that you had with that person? And, you know, because somewhere we lose out on the bigger picture also in life. And does that help?
It definitely helps. But when it becomes the topic of today, that is unfinished emotional business, we do not even want to look at that. We get stuck only on the issue in which we have this major disagreement or fight. We cannot look beyond that. There was a cute joke. A husband and wife had a fight. Just stopped talking to each other. One day, the wife came into the drawing room where the husband was sitting and started exploring every nook and corner of that room, looking under the sofa, removing the things from the display cupboard, looking this side, that side, everywhere. It went on for quite some time. Finally, the husband could not resist himself. He said, "What are you looking for?" And she said, "Aha, found it. I was looking for your voice," which had disappeared. See, that is where I say that look at the issue and don't look at the individuals. I'm sure most of you must have heard about this great lady, Dr. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross. She did extensive research, practical research, on what happens if you have disagreements with somebody and that somebody passes away. For years and years, day in and day out, she has closely interacted with such people. And they break down and cry and say, if only I had mended the fences before she died. I just picked up a few from her book. Somebody told her, I am so guilty.
It's a PPT form.
Yes, can you have that? I've listed that down. You can have a look at it. It will be easy for you. Dr. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, who has done extensive work with people who are dying and who have also passed away. The issues which, you know, she heard number of times, it says that I am so guilty for what? I didn't call mom regularly. It took me 5 minutes of a phone call to call her up. She's old, she's alone, she's not keeping good health. But every time I kept postponing. Equally important, I never got to say I am sorry. There are certain issues which after some time you realize that maybe I was unreasonable. If so, I should have approached her and said, I am sorry. But we procrastinated. We didn't do it. And now it's too late to say sorry. People tell her, I thought we had more time. And now that time is gone. I was planning one day I'll go, you know, she lives in another city. I'll go there, meet her, you know, maybe apologize or say things, right? But time was the great leveler and time did not give permission. I wish I had done things differently. I should have heard him out. I still can't understand why he behaved that way. If you wanted to, in a nice, relaxed atmosphere, you could have comfortably brought up the topic and said, you did something, your behavior hurt me. But I don't understand why you behaved in that manner. That is what we teach in empathy, right? That it is not what his behavior was, but why his behavior was like that. The moment you do that, you really get a sort of enlightenment. You can look at things from a different perspective. So now, let us look at what we can do today to bring a close to a relationship where we have had some unfinished emotional business. Pooni will run you through this little slideshow and you can add more to it.
In fact, if you are ready with a quick paper pencil, I think that shows the readiness also, you know, you could write down these points that bring to mind one or two emotional incompletions that continue to haunt you. It could be at any walk of life or at any age of life also. Could be with a very good friend of yours in school with whom it just fizzled out for some now when you look back, it could seem like a reason which was not very important enough for you to have, you know, let go of that relationship. You could have gotten back to that, or maybe something which is even as recent, which may have affected a very good relationship with you. So just make a jotting of one or two emotional incompletions. Write them down, because we all believe that writing is a very powerful tool. When you write it, when you read it, it brings in so many different perspectives to you yourself, that hey, I'm writing this, what did I do? Write down the smallest next step you can take. So we always say that, you know,
it could be, for example, sending a birthday greeting to the person, sending a small gift to that person, the smallest next step that you can take.
And that is, I think, also without expecting anything from the other end.
That's right.
It's just a good gesture from your end, no, Ali?
Yes.
Without
yes.
expecting absolutely unconditionally.
Yes.
Whether that person says, oh, what's wrong with you? Doesn't matter.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because this will help you to understand that yes, I have set my intention to complete this particular unfinished emotional business of mine. Your earnest effort is seen in that, and every small step will take you towards the bigger picture. Yeah, accept yourself as you are, including your weaknesses. I think this also brings us to a little bit of a point of being a little self-aware of about our own selves. So if I know that my weakness is this particular point or that point, or my strength is, you know, in communicating or clarifying misunderstandings, anything that it is, it helps us to analyze our own strengths and weaknesses, helps us into being more self-aware also about our own selves. So we say that accept yourself as you are, including your weaknesses. I think that's a very valid point, that stop trying to prove yourself. So don't try to prove that you were right. Don't try to prove that you are holier than thou, or don't try to prove that, no, I am self-righteous and what I did was absolutely right. This other person did something unethical, or it was not right, not in my principles. We keep trying to even rationalizing that my behavior was appropriate because I think like this. So can we stop trying to prove ourselves and let go of the past by giving up expectations? Whatever expectation, we are full of expectations, especially in very important and significant relationships. So if we can let go of that. Ali, self-awareness and empathy, your good.
Yes, absolutely. When you are willing to take responsibility, you know, it frees you. You don't have leftover emotional baggage. If you say, this is what I want to do, and this is what I can do. If it's difficult, you know, meeting up with the other person, then there's a very interesting technique called the empty chair. You keep two chairs, you sit in one, the chair in front of you facing you is empty, but you visualize that person there and you carry out a monologue, tell what you feel, and then get up from this chair, go to the other one and sit down there and give the other person's viewpoint. If you do this regularly, a lot of things can be resolved.
In fact, I think it takes us towards empathy.
That
why is this person doing what they are doing, and we can surely put ourselves into their shoes.
Absolutely. So with that, it's time for my break. Purni will quickly update you on the activities happening in Bundara. Yes. I'll be back in a minute.
Yes, I will. So, here I am with some information for you. And one is that most of y'all and must be knowing that we offer free counseling at Banjara Academy. So, how can this be? It can be, say, face to face. So, all that you need to do is call up our office, or in case the phones are a little busy or anything like that, please do not waste any attempt to reach out to us. We always try and return back the missed calls, but for some reason, sometimes, you know, the calls don't get registered on the mobile, and then you will not be able to reach out, and we would also want to be with you on that, right? So please send us a WhatsApp message or send us a normal message. We are still in the habit of reading the normal SMSs, as they call. So we do read those also. Let us know a convenient time, convenient day, and a convenient counselor. If you want somebody age appropriate, you know, if you have any special requirements like that, we'd be more than happy to do that for you. Or particular language, that also we can work on, because your comfort is very important, and anything like that, do run it by us. We'll be happy to do it. Then face to face is done, and then we have a telephonic counseling. So we have our counselors who may not be coming to the academy, but then they take calls from the comfort of their homes itself, and they don't feel to reach out. So that is another thing. If for any reason you are good in your writing, or if you feel that, no, I don't want to disclose any identity, anything like that, does not matter. You can write an email to us. So counseling is free. Even career counseling is free. So counseling of any type. We have the opportunity of meeting so many different youngsters and elders who would like to, you know, carve out their own career path. So that happens. In fact, Anish just put up a poster. We are offering a free service as a contribution to the society to help a lot of people select their career path. So we are having free career webinars coming up. And this one, which is, say, you know, on finance, which is coming up on October 25th, followed by design and related in November, followed by environment and zoology related careers in December. The medical and paramedical is already over, but we have put it up for your immediate reference. So we are just taking it up one by one, and these are all webinars. So pan world, anyone can, you know, get to understand. So Ali, along with the domain specialist, we'll all be here. They'll be here to guide you. You can ask questions. And even after that, you can, you know, be in touch with us. So that is one thing. Then, of course, we are all very face-to-face, classroom kind of people. So we are going to have a career guidance workshop, which is on October 21st. So yeah, here it is. So this is basically for you to help people in, you know, helping them with their careers, how to select, what to keep in mind, and ensure that, you know, your career path is easy, smooth, and because you open up to the world. Na? So we have this is a classroom session. This is a paid program, and the posters are out, and the invites are out, the Google Forms are out, and we will be sending it to you. Even if for some reason you don't have it, it's there on our website, and we will, just one message to us, and we'll see to it that it reaches out. Please help us to send this to various people. And we have DCS, you know, na? It's a Diploma in Counseling Skills, our classroom course. We also have so many who basically want to know about counseling, but are I mean, I'm not able to do it because either they have a baby at home or they have some elders at home who really are, you know, ill, have to be taken care of, they're infirm, or their job is so demanding from Monday till Saturday that they do not really find time to travel and come and attend the classroom sessions. So as a special privilege for those, because of their zeal to learn, we have extended the facility of International Program in Counseling and Guidance, which is IPCG. That is our course, which is online. So the lessons come to you by mail. The speciality is that there is a mentor through the whole course with each and every student individually. It is a self-paced program. So that facility also we are providing to those who would want to do a online counseling and guidance course. So these are a few announcements from our end. And now over to a lot of your thoughts and a lot of your opinions and questions. So good, Ali, we have many good thoughts coming
yes,
up.
Yes. Surekha says, I once told a parent, you have suppressed anger and bitterness against your ex-spouse, and that is why your child is not getting 100% of her mother. She's probably getting 60 to 70% of her mother, because of the remaining 30% is invested in hatred, in resentment towards your ex-spouse, and your child is paying the price of it. This is a real life example that Surekha has shared with us, and there are so many like that. It is because that counselee, that lady, has not been able to complete. Yes, she went through a very bad time, we acknowledge that. She was miserable. She had many, many, you know, situations where she was very upset. But now that that chapter is over, her child is the center of her attention. She should be giving a lot of love and affection to her child. But that does not happen because of the unfinished emotional business. If you are in a second relationship or second marriage or ready to get into one, you are really not ready if you haven't gone back and figured out what you did to ruin the first one, or run the first one into the ditch.
You have to have a relationship autopsy.
Autopsy,
yes. I like that word, autopsy.
yes, Surekha. That's very good advice. This is what we keep telling everybody. Never get into a relationship on the rebound. As long as you are carrying the emotional baggage of a past relationship, legally, financially, physically, the relationship may be over. But is it over emotionally? That is what we are discussing today. Surekha also brings out a very good point. We need to ask ourselves, what am I hiding from? What am I afraid to give a voice to? This thinking helps us in bringing a closure to some underlying issues that could be the trigger for trivial upsets and superficial issues. Sometimes it helps to get your child into the picture. Don't say bad things about the child's father, but just say, this is what happened. I could not handle this. I went through that very bad phase, and darling, I am carrying a little bit of that baggage. Will you support me? That is how it goes. So we keep getting. Sharayu is saying good afternoon, Ali, and Purnima. Good afternoon to you also, Dr. Sharayu. She's always with us on the FB Live programs every Saturday, all the way from Dharwad. She's a medical doctor who has achieved a lot, not only in her work as a physician, but also in the social work that she has done in the city of Dharwad. Surekha says, if there is unfinished emotional business, then you will live your life looking over your shoulder. That's a very good phrase, Surekha.
She says, and then your past will become your present and your future.
And your future. It will continue to govern your thoughts and thereby influence your emotions and thereby affect your behavior and your actions with people who had no role to play for what you went through. You had a bad relationship with one person, however close that person is, but you cannot penalize anyone. And this is a very good example. If a parent has been gone through a very bad time with the spouse, the parent should understand that and give extra love and affection to the child. The child has done nothing to contribute towards whatever happened to your marriage, isn't it? That is what I want you to understand. It can be done. All you need to do is to open yourself out.
Ali, I have an example here to share. I know one of my good friends. So they had had some face-off with a very important relative of theirs. And there was a wedding in the family. So the son was getting married and extremely close to this friend of mine. And the wedding invitation was given, but in a little lackluster, informal kind of manner, you know. So this friend of mine took a decision that no, it's okay, we have got the invitation and the desire, we come. Let us not look into how did she call, why did she call, when, all those things, because the boy has been with us since childhood and that is more important because it is his very big day today. And she went for the wedding without getting too attached to the situations or getting involved into the whole working environment of the wedding process.
That's right.
And no, her presence was respected because she thought, let this person also not be in an embarrassing situation if everybody asks, hey, why has she not come? Why has she not come? I think that was a very mature behavior from her end.
Small if you things, can think that way, no, you can really do wonders. Surekha says,
shall I read it, Ali?
Yeah, please.
A ship sinks after the water begins to collect inside. If we are going to knock a hole in our relationship by carrying unresolved anger and resentment towards our partner about something that they have done, and if you are unable to forgive them, then you would be unable to set, then we will be unable to set ourselves free and move on. The toxic, unfinished emotional baggage will continue to contaminate our life.
Yes, as counselors, we see this day in and day out. You see, if a relationship has gone bad, that has left a person bankrupt or has left the person, you know, totally insecure, homeless, whatever it is, then it's a real problem. But just because there were arguments, there was unpleasantness, there was bitterness, and you have taken the decision to move on. When you do that, you have to make conscious efforts to unload that baggage. It's like you want to move forward, but you're carrying a backpack with heavy weight on it. Will you be able to run? Will you be able to even walk properly? No, no. So the first thing that you have to do is consciously, you know, remove that baggage.
Basically, we are talking of emotional bankruptcy.
Emotional bankruptcy. So, if you can't do it by yourself, seek the help of a counselor. Seek the help of somebody who can help you with this. But if you are a person who has suffered even because of one bad relationship, I think you deserve to counterbalance that by being nice to yourself. Somebody else was bad to you. Why do you want to be bad to yourself? Right? Sharia says,
emotions are on the roller coaster, but the impacts are deep. Maybe both sides patching need to be done willingly.
Agreed, Dr. Sharayu, but I would like to extend that to say, supposing the other person is not willing. So when you say both sides, the other person is a very angry person, very self-centered person, and says, no, I am right, you are wrong, I don't want to compromise. You can still resolve your emotions. You can still work on removing the person from your mind and your emotions, focusing on the other good people, the near and dear whom you have in your life. Strengthen those relationships based on which you can work. Surekha has come out with a very nice point.
Once in a while, we have to say, I'm pressing the reset button. I'm starting all over right here, right now.
Yes. Same way as your computer, your mind also has a reset button. It's not as easy as just punching a button, but over a period of time, it can be done. It is difficult, but not impossible. So please do introspect. Where are the areas where you are carrying this baggage of the unfinished emotional business? And consciously, practically work out on how you can overcome it. And spread the message to everybody. You will definitely, like Surekha gave the example of counseling, you will definitely come across people who are not willing to forgive and forget, not willing to let go. Tell them that doesn't matter. Are you willing to move on? Are you willing to drop that baggage which you are carrying in your mind? It is not for the sake of the other person who has hurt you. It is for your own sake. So resolve that unfinished emotional business. Get onto new business relationships. I'm using the word business, of course. All types of relationships where you may have very good interactions. You may get enriched. You may enjoy your life. Okay. So with that, Surekha says, road raged and unfinished emotional business of suppressed anger. Yes, to some extent at least it is true. See, somebody, total stranger, cuts in front of me, squeezes my vehicle so that I have to put the brake suddenly, and in the next 5 seconds that person zooms forward. How much is the hurt? How much has it affected you? 5 seconds, and he is gone. If that is the case, why do I waste my time putting down the glass, shouting at that fellow who is already 50 feet away from you, showing your anger on the other people who are there, who are just not interested listening to you? Madhavi says, I always get stuck with emotions and feelings. Both are same and they go hand in hand. Yes, the only difference being that feelings are also physical feelings, like I am cold, I am sleepy, I am tired, I am hungry. These are physical feelings. emotional feelings are, I am happy, I am sad, I am angry, I am excited, I am jealous. These are emotional. Though we use the word feelings, stick to what we call as emotions, which are mental feelings. Right? So with that, I wind up and I leave you in the good hands of Anis, who will just run through the topics of the next thing. Incidentally, next Saturday is Dasara, 12th of October.
12th.
So we will not be having this session, 19th, 26th, and again 2nd of November is Diwali, so there won't be any session. 9th, Purni will run you through the topics and explain very briefly about it. Then we shall wind up.
On the 19th of October, dealing with depression. So we are not talking only of sadness, we are moving much deeper than that, which is depression, and also how to help people. There are a lot of youngsters or elders or in many traumatic situations, people could feel depressed. And so very much happening in children. So dealing with depression and helping others. Preparing for marriage. I think Surekha will be happy to see this topic, because Surekha works immensely in this area, and it is almost like a mission for her to ensure that people are not just ready for the Sangeet and for the Mehendi and for those rituals and ceremonies, but it's also to prepare for, not for the wedding, but also for the marriage at large. So whether it is yours or it is for others, this is seemingly a fantastic topic and a very popularly used word nowadays, gaslighting. On 9th of November, we have, if somebody is gaslighting you, how do you face it? How do you manage it? How do you counter it? So we have Facing Gaslighters, and on the coming week, we do not have a FB Live topic on the occasion of the festival of Dasara. Dealing with depression. Here are the posters. These posters are made by Anu. She's such a fine girl at the academy. She's studying, and at the same time, whenever we ask for any posters or anything like that, bang on, Anu is there to give us the posters and send it. So in her free time after her college, she works on these, and she ensures that our social media and other things are kept updated with good reading material. So you can also follow us on Instagram, Banjara Academy. A lot of good reading material. So visually also you can see it, no? You can kind of scroll left or you can scroll right, and you will get that. So here we are with the next week's topic, and wish you a very nice festival time, be it Dandiya or Garba or Devi Puja or Navratri, by whatever name that it is called, the festivity, let it be on, and may you have wonderful times with all your loved ones, and work on your unfinished emotional business. And if this season helps you to do it, we'll be more than happy. So with that, signing off from Banjara Academy, have a lovely time to each of you.